Let me paint you a picture of our planet more than 1 billion years ago. The land is barren and rocky, but the shallow oceans are a tropical paradise with mats of greenish microbes coating the shallow sea floors under a hazy orangish sky. They spread out, growing for miles and building on top of each other as they reach for the sun. Despite the biological bounty, this time period is so far back that we have almost nothing in the fossil record to tell us about it. Even the geological record is piecemeal, with the rocks having been messed up and destroyed over the eons. But there is one band of mountains where pieces of this paradise were preserved. The Appalachians, running through the northeastern U.S., give us a unique snapshot into this ancient world, thanks to their long history of formation. And central to that story is this rock, called Franklin Marble. To understand why the Appalachians are so special, we need to get into plate tectonics. Some of the most dramatic examples of plate tectonics on our planet can be found at the boundaries between plates, where two pieces of continental crust smush into each other and build huge mountain ranges. The classic example is the Himalayas, formed as the Indian subcontinent slow motion crashes into Asia. And yes, that is present tense. It is happening right now. The Himalayas are a kind of simple version of this because the Indian subcontinent is just gonna keep pushing in one direction until it peters out and stops. But on geological timescales, tectonics is rarely that simple or that long-lasting. Usually things tend to be more cyclic. Perhaps no place exhibits this more clearly than the Appalachian Mountains. This single mountain range has more than a billion-year-long history, consisting of five continental collisions and two periods when the tectonic plates reversed and started moving away from each other. And while different parts of the 3,200-kilometer-long range contain different parts of its history, New Jersey has some of the oldest rocks that help us to tell this whole story. So let's start at the beginning, around 1.3 billion years ago in the late Mesoproterozoic. Much like today, the continents of the world were scattered, fragmented by the shattering of the ancient supercontinent Nuna some 200 million years earlier. And also like today, those continents were on their way to joining up once again. The continent of Laurentia, which is the home of most of modern-day North America, began to collide with Amazonia, which is what we'd now call the northern part of South America. This collision led to the assembly of a new supercontinent known as Rodinia. But this wasn't like a nice, tidy cozying up of continents. Things got messy. Geologists think that the convergence started out as a subduction zone, with the oceanic crust of one tectonic plate sliding underneath the other. Like we see in subduction zones today, this would have led to melting in the mantle above the subducted slab, creating magma that rises up and creates a volcanic arc next to an ocean trench. But the mechanics of subduction zones also create another feature on the overriding plate called a back arc basin. Essentially, the volcanic arc sitting right at the edge of a colliding plate changes the way the tectonic forces act on that plate. And behind it, things switch from pushing to pulling, extending the crust instead of compressing it. We can see examples of these back arc basins today in the Sea of Japan, which was formed by extension between Japan and Eastern Asia while the Pacific was crashing into Asia. Underwater between Samoa and New Zealand, there's another back arc basin opening up to the east of the subduction zone between the Pacific and the Australian plates. Often, back arc extension creates small, relatively shallow seas just behind the continental edge, and geologists think this is what happened at the edge of Laurentia about 1.3 billion years ago. And it just so happened that this warm, sunlit sea was the ideal place for ancient life to thrive. These days, tropical seas are often home to busy coral reefs, complete with schools of browsing fish and the occasional lurking predator. But back in the Mesoproterozoic, none of these creatures had evolved. That did not stop these ancient tropical oceans from being a haven for life, though. Organisms had started photosynthesizing at least a billion years earlier, and all manner of bacterial and eukaryotic life got in on the trend. Drawing dissolved carbon dioxide from the oceans, green algae and cyanobacteria colonized the open water and the seafloor, wherever the light touched. The seabed was covered with these vast microbial mats made of interlocking bacterial fibers that wove themselves together into a kind of organic fabric. And since grazing marine animals like mollusks and worms wouldn't evolve for another 500 million years or so, there was nothing to stop them from growing like crazy, so they were kind of all over the place. Despite their abundance, we don't actually have many actual fossils from this time period. Bacteria and algae are made up of squishy carbon-based compounds without any mineral skeletons or shells, so they tend to rot away as soon as they die. But what we do have are stromatolites. Stromatolites are a kind of bacteria sediment lasagna built up over thousands of years. You start out with simple photosynthesizing cyanobacterial mats spread out over the seafloor to catch as much sunlight as possible. But over time, those mats would become covered in sediment. The sticky organic fabric would trap and bind particles and even chemically precipitate minerals like calcium carbonate. All that mineral stuff would end up blocking the sunlight to the photosynthesizers, so the microbes would migrate upwards to recolonize the new surface of the sediment. The process then repeats, with more minerals being trapped and precipitated, and the photosynthesizers creeping back up into the sun over and over again. The result, after thousands of years of growth, is a domed, layered, mineralized structure that may also contain some of the carbon of the original bacteria trapped within it. These layered biosedimentary structures aren't very common anymore, but they were a major feature of the Proterozoic seas, and were the microbes' answer to living on a changeable seafloor. And unlike a squishy microbe on its own, a stromatolite is built to stand the test of time. So in the back arc basins, next to the colliding continents of Laurentia and Amazonia, stromatolites grew amongst the carbonate sediments. Over time, they were buried completely and became incorporated into deep limestone deposits that may have been about 2 kilometers thick. And since this was still very much an active tectonic setting, the limestone rock would occasionally be injected with fluids from the nearby volcanic arcs, depositing metals like zinc amongst the calcium carbonate. But this tropical volcanic microbial Eden wasn't gonna last forever. Laurentia and Amazonia kept on grinding towards each other, and eventually the volcanic islands and back arc basin were crushed together as the edges of the continents touched. This collision took about 200 million years in total, and by the end of it, around 1 billion years ago, Laurentia and Amazonia were melded together to form the core of the new supercontinent Rodinia, with a towering range called the Grenville Mountains marking the dividing line. The back arc limestones were buried inside these mountains up to 20 kilometers below the surface, where the intense heat and pressure transformed it from sedimentary rock into metamorphic marble. This was the birth of the Franklin marble, sometimes known as Franklin ore, considering the deposits of zinc it contains. There's a lot more that has happened to these rocks over the millennia, so here's a real quick rundown of like 800 million years of plate tectonics. Another 200 million years or so later, tectonic forces shifted and the Rodinian supercontinent shattered. Laurentia was sent off on its own, with the remnants of the Grenville Mountains and the Franklin marble at their core still clinging to its edge. Then, around 450 million years ago, the ocean basin was swallowed underneath the supercontinent, smushing another volcanic arc onto the side of the Grenville Mountains, burying the Franklin marble and chemically altering its composition. It would take yet another mountain-building event in the early Permian, around 300 million years ago, for these ancient layers to see the light of day. At this time, the African continent collided with Laurentia as the assembly of Pangaea was completed. The impact pushed these Grenville Mountains and the Franklin marble all the way back up to the surface, and thus ended the game of bumper cars that gave us the Appalachian Mountains. Pangaea is long gone, as is Nuna and all the other supercontinents you may not have heard of before today. But the plates are still moving, and there's bound to be more collisions in the future. The places where we find Franklin marble are among the oldest parts of the Appalachian Mountain range, alongside other places like the Blue Ridge Mountains and the Adirondacks in New Jersey. And the region where these pretty rocks come from is valued for its fertile soil, the zinc deposits, and the lime that can be used for building. Studying these rocks has allowed geologists to piece together a lot of this super ancient geologic history, revealing the unexpected existence of an extensional back arc basin sandwiched between 2 colliding continents. And as for the rest of us, Franklin marble serves as a handy reminder of 1 billion years of American continental history, bringing together sedimentary, igneous, and metamorphic processes shaped by the tiniest microbes and the biggest supercontinents. Not bad for this unassuming little rock. Rocksbox subscribers are getting their own piece of Appalachia's history in this month's box. Every month, we send our Rocksbox Club a hand-picked mineral and the story of what makes it so cool. If you want to learn more and maybe join the waitlist, head over to scishow.rocks or click the link in the description. Thank you, as always, for watching.